Welcome to Money Making Conversation. I am your host, Rashawn McDonald. Let's be real about everything I do on this show. It's time to stop reading other people's success stories. I always tell people buy books, they watch TV. It's your story. That's the story I want you to start writing. And I always tell people to lead with their gifts, their passion, the things that they believe in. But what happens is a lot of people let their age, they let their friends, family, or coworkers stop them from planning or living their dreams. So I bring interviews on my show from celebrities, CEOs, entrepreneurs, and what I like to call industry decision makers who make a difference in people's lives. And they tell their stories, and hopefully the nuggets you get from their stories will push you forward to your successful story. My next guest is Rebecca Jarvis. She's an Emmy Award-winning journalist. She is ABC News Chief Business, Technology, and Economics Correspondent, the host and creator of The Dropout, a top-rated podcast that chronicles the rise and fall of Elizabeth Holmes, and the host and creator of the highly acclaimed No Limits with Rebecca Jarvis podcast, which features game-changing women. Now, as Chief Business, Technology, and Economics Correspondent, she reports for all ABC News programs, including Good Morning America, World News Tonight with David Meir, Nightline, 2020, and This Week with George Stephanopoulos. She is on the show to discuss the latest ABC News original. It is an in-depth look at the jaw-dropping stock market twists and turns and the stunning chain of events now synonymous with the name GameStop. Please welcome to Money Making Conversations, Rebecca Jarvis.
Hey, what an introduction. Thank you for having me. I love what you're doing here. It's fantastic. I love the conversations you're having and helping people really figure out the building blocks of success. So thank you for what you do. And thanks for having me.
Well, great, because we're both storytellers. And when I read your stories, and like I told before we got off the air, I just saw GameStop. When I try to do my interviews, I try to read a book the day before, or see the show, the movies, the day, you know, within a 24-hour cycle. That way, everything's fresh. I'm not writing notes or trying to remember something. But before we get started, I gave all these titles, but let's learn about your educational background. Can you tell us a little bit about you, how you got started from an academic standpoint, which led you to ABC through CBS?
Yes, fantastic. Great. I'm glad we start there because it is such an important place to be in. So grew up in Northeast Minneapolis. My mom is a journalist. She's a writer. And my grandfather was also a journalist. And I always wanted to do that as a career. But they both told me, if you start that as a career, you're going to be graduating from college with a lot of student loan debt, and you will not be able to pay it off if you start out as a journalist. So I went to college at the University of Chicago. I always gravitated towards math as a kid. I loved math. I also liked writing. And I ended up studying economics in college and then immediately pursuing jobs early on out of college in investment banking. And the reason I share that is that for me, I was graduating pretty significantly in student loan debt. I had about $30,000 in student loan debt at my graduation. And I, in part, chose investment banking and a career in finance because for me, it was going to be a way that I was going to be able to know that I could make my student loan payments. I didn't have a financial safety net, so there wasn't anyone else who's going to be paying those student loan payments upon graduation. And I did that job for about 2 years until I got to a point where I felt like I could comfortably continue to pay down my loans and pay them off, and then started at that point pursuing journalism jobs.
Well, those jobs have led you to all these shows that you now respected and cover. But isn't it a lot of pressure, or a lot of a clear understanding that people come to you for the facts? And so you have to do your due diligence and your homework, and you have to have relationships that tell you this is the fact. Ride with it or run with the story.
Yeah. And just like you, you know, you mentioned at the top of this program, you do your homework, you do your research. And I spend a lot of time digging into the data and the information and looking at numbers. A lot of my work today is spent reading research reports. And especially in the early days of my career, starting out in finance, one thing I tell a lot of people, they ask me what the best way to get into journalism is. And for me, the best way was not necessarily going at it directly. It wasn't starting out and applying to newspaper and TV jobs right away. Instead, it was having that financial background that both lends me credibility today when I have to look at complicated pieces of financial information. And that's certainly something that we did with GameStop, the documentary you mentioned at the beginning that's now streaming on Hulu that chronicles the rise and fall of the GameStop stock price and the phenomenon. I mean, to be able to look at the stock market, you really do have to have, or at least for me, it comes comes in handy to have a background in it and to really understand it. So starting out in finance, while it wasn't directly walking into a newsroom and starting out maybe as an intern or a junior level reporter, it allowed me in some ways to fast track my career so that when I did start applying for journalism jobs, I was coming into a newsroom with some credibility around this topic that I was going to cover, which ultimately today is now business, technology, and the economy. But in the early days of my career was really business based. And I could go to editors, and this is what I did. I cold called. I was in Chicago at the time, and I called up business editors in Chicago and asked them out for coffee. And I talked to them about their job, asked them how they got to where they got to. And I would go to each of those meetings with some ideas, pitches for them, story pitches. And at the end of the meeting, I would always say, I have some ideas that I would really like to share with you. I'd be interested in writing them for you if you ever had an opportunity for that. And I would share the ideas, and they were all based on things that I saw in finance. And so if you are somebody who's on a path, especially to journalism, I think nothing beats great story ideas. So if you have a background or you're seeing things, bring those ideas to, and again, it can be cold calling. That's how I did it. I didn't know anyone. I didn't have a special leg up. I just contacted them. I went on their websites. I looked for the right person. I reached out. I contacted them. And another thing I would say about my story that I think is really something that I encourage everyone to do, ask people to coffee without any kind of reservation. I mean, you don't have to have a specific pitch to someone about why you're going to get to know them. You could say, I'm interested in your industry. Tell me more about yourself. I want to get to know you. And nowadays, I mean, we can do this over Zoom. You can do it over social media. You can do it on LinkedIn. All of these different platforms are entry points. And I tell people the most important thing to focus on is not who doesn't return your call, who doesn't return your email. It's the one who does, because it only takes one to land the job that is going to bring you to your dream career.
We will be right back with more money-making conversations with your host, Rashawn McDonald.
The HBCU College Day Tour will be on the campus of Clark Atlanta University on Saturday, September 25th. It's for all high school juniors and seniors and young adults, and it's free. If you're interested in aviation, healthcare, technology, mechanics, or even traveling out of space, the United States Air Force and HBCUs have a place for you. We will be on the campus of Clark Atlanta University Saturday, September 25th from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. HBCU College Day registration is free at HBCUawards.com.
Welcome back to Money Making Conversations with your host, Rashawn McDonald.
Let me tell you a little bit about myself. So you can, when we start talking, you get a sense of where I'm coming from a in-depth, okay? My degree is in mathematics. My minor is in sociology, okay? And so economics, I tried that degree plan, couldn't get through. I tried my degree plan in engineering, couldn't get through, but math was a natural for me. Got that degree. Cool. I have invested in the stock several different times. One, I trusted myself, and then I went into the little funds. That's who. And then recently, I decided I'm going back to where I used to think. I would pick the stocks that I wanted to. And I went to my Merrill Lynch, is where I do my stock investment through. And I said, these are the stocks they want to. Well, we're going to put you in the funds. I said, no, I want to do these stocks. I'm going back to what I trust, myself and my thought process. So I want to let you know I have some understanding of the stock market. I'm arrogant enough to tell people what I want to invest in. Not saying it may be the right, but I'm arrogant enough to say that. And so when we start talking about GameStop, it helped me a lot to understand what's going on, but I also have some thoughts about Robinhood, that app, which I'm really... You know, it was really interesting, Rebecca. I knew about, I was on the outside of this story until I saw your documentary. So it really brought me inside and let me know how the stock market really is about everyday people. So what brought you into the story of GameStop?
First of all, thank you for sharing that background. I love that you have that background, that you're interested in. I think that's kind of where a lot of people are coming from. You know, I covered the financial crisis, the Great Recession of 2007, 2008. And what I saw happening in the financial crisis were so many people looking at their savings, their retirement savings accounts dwindling because the market was collapsing, and they sold And had they not sold in that environment, had they held on, they would have made their money back and then some within 3 years. Those who sold in the financial crisis were the ones who lost the half of their life savings on average. And so to me, I'm always drawn to these various events around the stock market that captivate and capture everyone's attention, because I see a responsibility in my role covering this for ABC News to be someone who can remind people of history. And when I saw GameStop in particular, a single stock that was boosted by hysteria and excitement and this new trend of people really spending more time online because of the pandemic and having this technology in their hand via an app called Robinhood, such that they could trade 24/7. It reminded me of the importance both of the role to make sure that people were getting good information, solid information, and then also to really want to help people understand the difference between, for example, putting money into an individual company like GameStop versus putting money into a 401k or an IRA, which is investing, it's saving for the long term. GameStop is more the equivalent, and it's not just GameStop. Anytime you put money into a single stock, it is the equivalent of betting. It's the equivalent of gambling and walking into a casino, because if you're thinking of it in a short-term thing, a single stock can go up or go down. You can lose money, you can make money on a single stock. If you think about the stock market as a whole, the collective stock market over time historically goes up about 7%. Now, 1 year out of 30, it might go down, it might go up. But over time, if you invest for the long haul, that's the most tried and true form of saving, because over time, the market does go up. But you have to be in it for the long haul to capitalize on that. Whereas with a company like GameStop, you never know. And just the hysteria, I mean,
Let me ask you this, because I want to make sure I'm on the same page with you about Robinhood. Now, I saw Robinhood as an app, okay?
Yes.
An app that you can go and buy stock on, right? I mean, you could buy Intel, you could buy Apple, you can buy GameStop in this situation. Am I correct? Okay, cool. Now, the problem we had with Robinhood was that, well, as you go through the story, GameStop, everybody was buying GameStop through their app, and they didn't have the funds to cover the buys.
Yes. So all of these brokerages, whether it's Robinhood or Charles Schwab or any other brokerage, when you use the app on your phone, they have to have enough collateral to make sure that they can cover any trade that you make on your phone. And there's an outside agency that oversees all of this, that makes sure that Robinhood and Charles Schwab and all the other brokerages are safe, essentially, to do and conduct business in the way that they're conducting it. Well, what happened is GameStop, so many people were buying GameStop, and many of them were using the Robinhood app to do it, but they were using all different kinds of apps as well. So many people were buying GameStop that it just became explosive. It was larger than life, and that added new risks to the system. And as a result of those new risks, Robinhood, as well as a number of other brokerages, got this collateral call, which said, you have to put up way more money than you have ever put up before in order to back these trades. And as a result, Robinhood says it made this decision to restrict buying of GameStop. And they did this on January 28th. And after they did this, you saw the stock of GameStop plummet. It was like, it was going like this, and then it went like that.
Absolutely. Because there's a couple of people on this, doing this special, like Jim Cramer. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. See, there's another guy that's kind of like, he's kind of like the funny man version of Jim Cramer, who got everybody hyped up. He wears
Dave
the funny
Portnoy.
He has the funny hats and everything. But I beg to differ. I go way back to, I want to say, I was writing on Me and the Boys, but about 95, between 2000, Jim Cramer was coming out of the box, kind of like this guy. Hyping stuff, that's on television. I mean, I was sitting there, Rebecca, making decisions on BAM, making decisions on Office Depot, making decisions on Kmart stock based on what Jim was saying. So I thought it was kind of like ironic listening to him being interviewed, and you did the same thing that this guy was doing, so much so that Jon Stewart called you out for giving overhyped information on your show, and he had to come on Jon Stewart's show to say, oh, yeah, I apologize, so to speak. And so when he was being interviewed, I was like, okay, Jim Cramer, really? You gonna sit up here and act like you weren't that version of this guy? Because we as fans of trying to get information, that's why I love this show, because I'm going like, I've been on this journey, Rebecca. I've been a GameStop participant, just at a different time period, because it happens all the time, because we it might not be as drastic as this, Rebecca, but we still are led by a lead. All we want is a lead. And when we look at these people and they give us information that may be right or wrong, they do their little indemnification. Don't follow me. I'm not an expert. Don't lead in. But bye. And so when you brought Jim Cramer in, what was the purpose of bringing him in? Because like I saw him as a different role, because I had a different experience with him, because he was a younger version. He was an older version of what I was seeing now being exposed in this documentary.
Sure. So I misspoke. I wasn't sure who you were talking about, and I thought you were talking about someone else. You were talking about Roaring Kitty. So
yes.
Just some background. So there's a person, his name is Keith Gill, but he also has the YouTube name Roaring Kitty. Mm-hmm. And he has a Reddit name that I can't say here. Yes. Because we would both get in trouble for my language. Mm-hmm. But he is one of the first people who spotted GameStop.
Absolutely.
When it's $4. It was trading only a few dollars a share. Mm-hmm. He thought it was something that had value. He talked about it all over social media. Mm-hmm. A lot of people started to follow what he was saying, and they started pouring money in. And when he first started talking about GameStop, it was about $4 a share. Mm-hmm. 6 months later, it got up to $350 a share. And there was a lot of conversation on Reddit and other places on social media about the importance of putting money into GameStop and this idea that if all the sort of little guys decided to act collectively together, that they could really drive up the price of GameStop. Full disclosure, I started my career at CNBC in television and in business television. I have a lot of great friends there. Jim Cramer is one of them. But the reason that I wanted Jim Cramer mm-hmm. to be a part of our conversation for this story is because he has a front row seat. The people who watch Mad Money on a regular mm-hmm. basis are many of the people who are investing in individual stocks. They're looking for that leg up. They're looking for that information. And I think what's really important to keep in mind, and I think this story is illustrative of that, is, you know, there's two sides to every position in the market. There has to be a buyer there has to be a seller in order for there to be a buyer. And I think that's what's so important, is to at least know what you're walking into. So if you're going to put money into something and it's an individual stock, you have to be okay with the possibility that you could lose money. Now, maybe all the statistics, all the data that you're reading is telling you, you know what, there's more upside than there's downside. Obviously, you probably have to think that way in order to put money in. But the reality is there can always be downside. And when you use leverage, which is what a lot of people are now doing, it's always been the thing that hedge funds and the sort of big money on Wall Street is always using debt. It's called leverage to bolster their trades. So if I believe really heavily in something, I can borrow. Right. If I'm a hedge fund, I can borrow from a bank more money to put into that individual stock. And that can help me make money if the stock goes up. But of course, I lose even more money if the stock goes down. And what's really important to keep in mind here is if you're an individual investor and you're using an app, then yes, some of these new apps like Robinhood will give you, if you meet certain criteria, they will give you access to that leverage. But it's so important to remember that if you're using that leverage and the stock goes down, you've not only lost the money that you put in, but you're actually out even more money because you're using debt to pay.
We will be right back with more money-making conversations with your host, Rashawn McDonald.
The HBCU College Day Tour will be on the campus of Clark Atlanta University on Saturday, September 25th. It's for all high school juniors and seniors and young adults, and it's free. If you're interested in aviation, healthcare, technology, mechanics, or even traveling out of space, the United States Air Force and HBCUs have a place for you. We will be on the campus of Clark Atlanta University Saturday, September 25th from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. HBCU College Day registration is free at HBCUawards.com.
Welcome back to Money Making Conversations with your host, Rashawn McDonald.
The thing about this the event is that I can, you know, this is like there's gold in them, their heels, you know, people ran for the gold. It felt like a gold rush. It felt so like different times in life we see this, the gold in them, their heels. People rush to the California and they risk their lives by going through dangerous Indian territory. So they might not risk money, but they risk their lives to try to seek that fortune. So that was the kind of like a period there. And then when you see in like in the 80s and 90s for the big bubble burst in 2007, mm-hmm. I was kind of there, you know, because that's when television, like the CNBCs came out and started showing you people talk about stocks and talking about how you can invest in different ways. And that's when I got introduced as an African-American to that. I remember me and Steve Harvey used to always act like we were stock experts. We'd sit around just talking. Well, we traded over. Didn't know nothing.
And you are.
You never know. We were what I feel that this show and your documentary or your news original special tells about. We were just everyday people. We gathered enough information to buy certain things based on a hunch and the belief that this would return on our investment. And that's what it showed. If some people lost, everyday people. Some people got out early, everyday people, and some mm-hmm. people still hung in there. And I thought that was really the kind of like end results of your documentary, is that it was a special about individuals who make their own decisions. They all got in for different reasons, Rebecca. They all got excited for different reasons. In the end, when it came time to either stay, pull the plug, they all did it for different reasons. That really had to be a strong emotional end to a well-documented special.
Mm. I'm glad you thought that. And, you know, to your point earlier, it's such a good point. We see these things happening over and over again. Mm-hmm. When the GameStop story first really took on a life of its own in sort of mid to late January, I was remembering the times during the dot-com bubble in 1999, 2000, mm-hmm. 2001, when all these tech companies were coming out. And even though some of the technology didn't exist that exists today, for example, Robinhood, the app, didn't exist back then, there were the early days of internet chat rooms. There were the early days of people hyping, pumping, and dumping individual stocks. So as much as things change because the technology might be new or the modes of communication might be evolved, this is something that does repeat itself time and time again throughout history.
You know, it's interesting that you know, Robin Hood, it had the great name, Rob from the Rich, Give to the Poor. So that's why it was really a good media app and to really become the center of the conversation. But they changed the rules right in midstream, you know, and companies do that all the time. It's like, for instance, you notice when the gift cards used to be, you could keep them forever. And then all of a sudden they came and changed the rules. So you know something, if you don't spend that gift card in a year, it's not going to be any good anymore, because it came back to what burdened down or came to be the collapse of what Robinhood had to do on that date and stop buying, is that if you don't have the money, if you have all these gift cards out there, you got to have capital to cover if one day somebody decides to show up and buy that gift and use that gift card. Mm-hmm. And so they decided to change the rules. All of them changed the rules to saying that we're going to limit the amount of time you have to buy this card. Otherwise, it's going to become invalid. And so that's what really wore down the whole principle of Robin Hood. They didn't think about how big they could get. And if they got that big, what's our answer? And their answer was to say, stop buying.
Right. And they really became the poster child, too, for all of the anger and outrage. Even though other brokerages made the same choice, it was because of that name, Robinhood, and the promise that they had made to democratize trading. And if you're saying you're going to democratize trading, but at the same time that, for example, a large hedge fund can do something different because they don't rely on your app, and your customer can't do that thing anymore, it does create a lot of problems.
Wow. Again, an amazing special on Hulu. It's an ABC News original. It's hosted by and presented by Rebecca Jarvis. You're amazing. I'm a big fan of yours. I definitely want to bring you back on the show to talk about No Limits with Rebecca, your podcast that features game-changing women, because I have six sisters. So I always try to promote, and I have a single daughter. So I always try to promote women and put them out there. And also, Elizabeth Holmes, we got to talk about her.
Her
story is amazing. Amazing. But again, I wanted to bring you on to talk about this GameStop, because first of all, I finally got educated on it because of your amazing special. It's on Hulu. Check it out right now. It streams 24 hours a day. It's amazing. Rebecca, thank you for coming on Money Making Conversations.
Rashawn, thank you so much. I really appreciate your interest and the great conversation. I'll come back anytime. This was fun.
Thank you. Again, if you want to hear any interviews or see any of my interviews on Money Making Conversations, please go to moneymakingconversations.com or my YouTube channel. I'm Rashawn McDonald. I am your host.